times are, all the fantastic fears that have been the subject of this story fell from him like dreams from a man waking up in bed. He remembered them clearly and in order, as mere delusions of the nerves. How the fear of the professor had been the fear of the tyrannic accidents of nightmare, and how the fear of the doctor had been the fear of the airless vacuum of science. The first was the old fear that any miracle might happen. The second, the more hopeless modern fear that no miracle can ever happen. But he saw that these fears were fancies, for he found himself in the presence of the great fact of the fear of death, with its coarse and pitiless common sense. He felt like a man who had dreamed all night of falling over precipices, and had woke up on the morning when he was to be hanged. For as soon as he'd seen the sunlight run down the channel of his foe's foreshortened blade, and as soon as he felt the two tongues of steel touch, vibrating like two living things, he knew that his enemy was a terrible fighter, and that probably his last hour had come. He felt a strange and living value in all the earth around him, in the grass under his feet. He felt the love of life in all living things. He could almost fancy that he heard the grass grow. Fancy that even as he stood, fresh flowers were springing up and breaking into blossom in the meadow. Flowers blood red and burning gold and blue, fulfilling the whole pageant of the spring. And whenever his eyes strayed for a flash from the calm, staring, hypnotic eyes of the marquee, they saw the fruit tuft of palm tree against the skyline. He had the feeling that if by some miracle he escaped, he would be ready to sit forever before that palm tree, desiring nothing.